Hey, Streetwalkers. I've been telling Steve for years, you need to put out the best episodes again so people can relive the thrill of the best ones, the ones that are really, really art. But that's almost all of them, isn't it, Streetwalkers? But this month, March 2024, you're going to get to hear my picks. Here we go.
I'm a fireball.
Hey, Streetwalkers, number 18 on Shawn's picks. Well, let's face it. This is a guy that Steve would leave me for, Jason Ritter. So cute, so charming, so humble. This is his second appearance on Fascination Street podcast, and probably on the third appearance, I won't have a husband anymore because he'll run off with him for real. I know you're going to cut all this. But seriously, he's got a serious man crush on Jason Ritter. Jason Ritter, you'll know from quite a few different TV shows, and he plays a phenomenally large role in Raising Dion. But no spoiler alerts here. Go watch Raising Dion. Jason Ritter, right here, number 18, Shawn's Picks on Fascination Street podcast.
Fireball.
Welcome back to Fast.
Sorry.
That's hilarious. Welcome back to Fascination Street Podcast, Jason Ritter. How are you doing today, man?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I can't complain, I guess. Yeah, I can't complain. Let's do that.
That sounds good.
So the last time that we chatted, Raising Dion Season 1 was over, and I don't even know if we were sure that there was going to be a season two of Raising
Dion. I don't think we were sure, yeah.
I think we're waiting to find out.
Yes.
And so I took the liberty of finding out. Just so you know, Jason, there will be a season two. And
oh, no
don't
way.
Tell.
Awesome.
Yeah, for real. And don't tell anybody, but you're in it. So.
Yeah! No way! Yay! That's awesome.
Now, I don't know if folks remember because they probably shouldn't, but go back and listen if you didn't or don't or whatever. I was completely unaware that that show existed, and it made me really angry at Netflix for not suggesting it to me because they suggest all kinds of stuff to me that I really don't care about, but they never mentioned Raising Dion at all. And the only reason that I found out about it is because when it was happening, you were tweeting about it because you're so proud of this project. And I was like, well, if this dude won't shut up about it, I might as well check it out. So I did, and I loved it. It is my wife and my new favorite show whenever it comes back.
That's awesome.
Blasted through it. And spoiler alert, it gets buck wild. So enjoy that for what it's worth. Now, everybody knows, because hello, everybody's paying attention to me, what I'm doing right now is a season two Raising Dion push. I want everybody on the planet to watch season two. And so if you haven't, go back and catch season one. And then season two is out right now. And as part of this push, this is sort of a coordinated effort. I normally release one episode a week, but for this special podcasting event, I'm releasing an episode every single day the week that season two of Raising Dion comes out. Now, in this week that I am releasing is Jason Ritter. Say hi, Jason.
Hello, I'm here.
The star, Dion himself, Josiah Young. Say hi, Josiah. Just kidding, he's not on.
Hi.
Sammy Haney.
Bad impression.
Terrible impression. Sammy Haney, Gavin Munn, and the showrunner and head writer, Carol Barbie.
Awesome.
Now, all of that to say, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing well. I'm doing pretty well as can be expected in this time period.
Yeah, whatever we're calling this. I can't wait to see what the history books say about this time. This is ridiculous.
Oh, boy.
So, Jason, the last time we talked, you had recently had a child.
Yes, I did.
Her name is a secret. So, how is your little baby girl?
She's doing great. Thank you for asking. She's in a nap right now. So,
Oh, I'll be quiet then.
Very happy. Sorry. Oh, no, you're fine. You're on headphones.
You can see me?
I can.
I am on headphones. Oh, that's neat. That's neat. Speaking of seeing each other, a few weeks ago, let's just say somewhere around, August 23rd is what I'm going to go with. There was a program on ABC.
Yeah.
And it was called Superstar John Ritter.
Yes.
So I guess one of the things that Hulu does, I guess, you know, they all do it. You turn on that app and it says, hey, you should watch this.
Mm-hmm.
And when we turned it on, it was a big old fat picture of your dad's face.
Oh, nice.
And my wife goes, oh, hey, there's your friend's dad. And I was like, oh, she means Jason. Because Jason probably doesn't know that we're friends, but my wife thinks we're friends. So I'm like, oh, yeah. That's Jason's dad. And the description said that you were in it.
Yes.
And you were. And while I'm sure that you spent a lot more time in front of the camera than made it onto the show, I was very disappointed at how much you weren't in the show.
Oh, I appreciate that. Maybe they'll release a DVD extra.
A director's cut.
Yeah, exactly. No, I mean, there were so many people in that show.
Yeah, there was a ton of folks.
Yeah.
Noticeably absent was Janet.
Oh, yeah. I missed her in that, too. I don't know anything about that.
Oh, of course you don't.
I would have loved for her to be part of that.
I was a little surprised. Well, first of all, I was a little angry that you told that story. You were like, hey, yeah, I'm the only one that's in every episode because see that little boy petting that goat? That's me. And I was like, oh, for shame. He told that on my show.
It has been out in the world in several places, I am sorry to say.
You better hush your mouth. Like I said, I was surprised to see that Janet wasn't on there and didn't participate, maybe. But I was equally surprised that Chrissy did, because I was under the impression that there was a little animosity between her and your father, which we're not going to talk about because nobody cares. But I will say, are you okay?
Am I okay?
Yeah, it seemed, and I imagine that it had to have been a very, very emotional experience.
Yeah, it was.
Are you all right?
Definitely. Yeah, I'm totally all right. I knew going into it that we were going to be talking about it. It's always a sort of more complicated and like when it just sort of surprisingly comes up. But, you know, I was prepared and, you know, they were so nice. I really appreciated everything that those guys did to make me comfortable. And I was really happy with it. And, you know, I knew that everyone who was going to talk about my dad was going to have a lot to say. And so I wasn't expecting everything that we talked about to be in there. And, you know, it was cathartic in a way. I think a lot of the stuff where like really broke down mercifully wasn't in it, which was nice. And so I got to have kind of like a little free therapy session in the studio.
Free? They better have paid you.
No, I didn't have to pay. But it was nice. And I thought that everybody they interviewed, I thought they did a great job. And, you know, I mean, there are so many people who are a part of his life who weren't a part of that special. And, you know, there's only so much you can fit into half an hour. So I don't blame anybody.
I don't blame ABC for that either, because you're right. There's only so much you can fit into that time frame. But I am wildly surprised that nobody has made a full-length documentary about him yet. And it's going to happen, I know it. But to your point, I think that everybody who was involved, which there was a lot of folks that, you know, they asked about your father and their experiences with him, they were so respectful and reverential that this is going to sound dumb. It made me like Hollywood a little bit more. Like, there's really only like a handful of people who have a reputation in Hollywood of being a really good person.
Oh.
You're on that list.
Oh.
With like Tom Hanks and Henry Winkler and stuff like that.
Oh,
but
man.
Most of the folks are not, us average fools don't really think that the Hollywood folks are all that kind. So it was really nice to see a bunch of respect and reverence for your father.
Yeah.
Who, like I told you last time, he raised me too.
Oh.
So he was my babysitter. And again, I can never thank you enough for sharing him with us and me specifically.
My gosh. Absolutely. Yeah.
Now, you made fun of yourself on Twitter because, well, I mean, I wasn't going to do it. But you were like, hey, everybody, pay no attention to all that water under my eyeballs. I wasn't crying. You're crying. So I'm glad they didn't show the snot slinging and stuff that you undoubtedly did.
Yeah.
But My wife told me I cannot ask this question, but who listens to their wife? Am I right?
Oh boy, you're in trouble now.
I have to ask you this question.
Yeah.
I mean this with respect and love, and whether you know it or not, we're friends. Okay, so I mean this in the most friendly way possible. What was going on with your hair?
Oh, that was what she was trying to protect me from? How sweet.
Yes, I go, what is wrong with his hair? She goes, leave him alone. Just leave him alone. It's probably for a roll or something. I was like, it better be for a roll, or he doesn't have good friends. What's going on with your hair on that show?
It is for a roll, I will say. Well, I should say it was for a roll, and then I haven't cared really enough to change it back to normal. So it's just been sort of sitting around remaining blonde on my head. And I've always had to be kind of dragged to get a haircut, or I just grab a pair of clippers and shave it all off. Well, you know, it's a thing that I don't particularly like thinking about or doing. Like in the pandemic, my hair got, I mean, we're still in the pandemic, but in that long period of time before I had any work, my hair just grew and grew and grew and grew and grew and got almost as long as I had it in high school. But, yeah, I've never been a huge fan of haircuts or hair changing, or I just, you know, I'm not the one who has to look at it all the time. So I kind of forget that it's blonde until I see it. And I did have a moment of like, oh, I'm going to go do this interview. Maybe now would be the time to change it. And then I just forgot. I just was having too much fun with my family.
I love it. So I guess, Melanie, it doesn't bother her either, I guess, huh?
I wouldn't say that it doesn't bother her. I don't think it's her favorite. I don't think it's her favorite in the world. But yeah, I think she'll be happy when it's gone. She tolerates it, I'll say. She doesn't actively tease me about it. But I've had some gently encouraging conversations with her about perhaps switching it up.
Well, none of my business, obviously, but you're way too good looking to have whatever that is on top of your head. So knock that off.
I appreciate that.
I love that you're like, well, it was for a role. And then I was like, well, I'm not going to do anything to my hair until somebody pays me to. I love that. Which is not what you said, but that's what I heard.
Yeah, it's a mostly laziness.
I love it. Well, at least you didn't do something horrific like have a rat tail or something. That'd be terrible.
That's true. I did not do that. Although, good idea. I'll tell Melanie, get ready for the next stage.
Oh, no. She already doesn't like me, dude. Don't do that. I'm just kidding. She doesn't know me, folks. She doesn't know me enough to not like me. Speaking of Melanie.
Yes.
You guys live in California, right?
We do, yes.
Okay, here's why I'm confused. I read somewhere that Melanie went ahead and thanked all of the baby doctors in Atlanta. Was your baby born in Atlanta?
She was, actually. At the very end of Raising Dion Season 1, she was born. Melanie came out to Atlanta for the last couple of months of her pregnancy after she finished working on something. And then we stayed in Atlanta for a little bit after Raising Dion was over just to kind of hang out and have some time, some quality time with our new little family.
None of my business again, but it sounds like y'all did that on purpose. Like you specifically didn't want this baby to be born in California?
No, it just was the luck of the draw. Even before Raising Dion started, Melanie was pregnant. We found out that I was going to get the part, but I said I can't actually sign on to it unless there's some time around this period because she's due while we would still be shooting. And so they made sure that we were all good from that point of view. And then it became clear that maybe I wasn't going to be able to fly home to Los Angeles. So we switched doctors and had it out in Atlanta.
Well, that is awesome. Your daughter is like the first generation of Ritters that wasn't born in California in like 5 or 6 generations, right?
Well, my dad was born in California, but I think it just goes back too because his parents were both...
Tex wasn't there?
No, Tex was born in Texas. That's how he got his name.
Don't you dare. Make me sound like a fool. What an idiot. What am I, Stoops? Oh, man.
When he moved to New York to be in the theater and make a go of it, everyone started calling him Tex because of his accent, and then it just sort of stuck.
That reminds me of the very first joke that I read when I was little in a joke book.
I love joke books.
And it goes like this. Hey, you can call me Tex. Why? Are you from Texas? Well, no, I'm from Maryland, but I sure don't want nobody calling me Mary.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hilarious. So
there you go.
That's why they're funny to first graders.
You know, if I find a ghost book in a shelf in a house somewhere, I flip through it because every once in a while there'll be a little gem in there.
Every very, very once in a while.
Yeah.
Jason, I think that's probably enough talking about your daughter. Good Lord. I'm not even supposed to mention her, and here I am.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors.
Hey, Streetwalkers. On February 26th, we will release our 400th episode. I want to give each and every one of you a huge thank you for riding with me all the way to this giant mile marker. For the first time since the show started, I'm going to be taking a little break for the month of March. There will be no new episodes, but instead, I'll release an older episode every weekday of the month in a best of style, showcasing some of my wife's favorite conversations. Enjoy these 21 Fascination Street classics Monday through Friday, every weekday in the month of March, and I'll be back with all new episodes beginning April 1st. I couldn't do this without you, so tell a friend. And thanks again for being Streetwalkers.
Let's get back into it.
Can you tell me that thing that you were working on that required you to have the worst haircut I've ever seen on you?
Well, you've seen it at a grown out. It's been months. You know, when it first happened, it was purposeful. And I don't want to say her name, because it's a spoiler, but she did a wonderful job on it. It was a very last minute decision, and so it was like, you know, she came in early and we got it done before that scene had to be shot later that day. It looked better than it looks now. Now it's like,
keep telling yourself that, buddy.
In other words, anything that looks bad now is my fault for not keeping it up.
Don't blame her.
Yeah.
Way to protect her.
Yeah, exactly. But I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure if I'm allowed. It's also a little bit of a spoiler thing. So, you know, the only thing that could happen is that part gets completely cut out. And then it looks like I've been lying to everybody. And I actually did this to myself on purpose. But I swear, at one point, I did have to do it for a job.
Are we to believe that you didn't do this on purpose?
Yes. Yes, we are. Unless I can't prove it down the line, in which case people are free to believe whatever they want to believe.
Oh, thank you so much, buddy. I love believing whatever I want. You are the greatest. So I know COVID's still a thing, but are you starting to come out of it and starting to do things and stuff?
A little bit. I have always erred on the side of caution. And so, you know, I'm still like very careful about it, because basically, you know, the way my brain goes is always sort of worst case scenario. You know, I know what statistics there are out there, but I also know how little comfort statistics are if you're on the short end of that stick. You know, my father having passed away and knowing what that feels like to lose a parent and being a parent, I just want to have as close to a 0% chance of delivering that pain to my daughter if I can avoid it. So, you know, I've really just been extreme about it. I wear masks outside. I still distance, even though I'm fully vaccinated. I just don't want to look back and go, oh my God, when did I get it? So that's me. That's how I'm dealing with it. I know people are dealing with it in a lot of ways. I just have always been like, I would be so upset with myself. I'm lucky enough that for the most part, I can avoid it. I'm not working somewhere where people are coming in and yelling at me or whatever for wearing a mask or getting in my face or anything like that. So I feel lucky in that regard. And I feel like I would have to go out of my way to contract it. So the least I can do is try not to get it as much as I can control. There's certain things that you can't control. But yeah, I mean, since it came out, it's been on my mind. Before I do anything, I consider the benefits and the risks. And then for the most part, I say, how about we just make this a Zoom call instead? But as we're hopefully coming out of it, I think I'll get a little bit more comfortable with certain things. But yeah, I've been as extreme as you possibly can be, just out of pure fear. Fear and self-preservation.
Oh, you're so cute. That's what a new parent does.
Yeah, exactly.
When you have your second kid, you're just going to like let him roll around in the dirt. That's how it happens. I'm glad that you guys, the three of you, are able to spend so much time together in these young and formative early months and years. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Now, I want to talk about this television program on Netflix called Raising Dion. It's based on a comic book. Like I said at the top of the show, I was unaware of it until you told me about it. So thank you for that. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
It really is one of our favorite things ever.
Your dad was traveling so much that year that he made me this video.
How's Dion doing? I miss my little man. I'm telling you, Nicole, that kid is something special.
You're such a special kid. You're charming, smart, very handsome.
Mom!
Pat said you were asking about your dad.
My mom won't tell me what happened. Just says it was a storm.
Is happening with Dion.
We should figure out how to get it under control.
How long do you think you can keep this up?
The government is tracking people
who got superpowers.
I know a few things about Dion. The storms are drawn to your son.
Where is my son? Ma'am, where is my son? It's you and me. You and
me. That's awesome.
So awesome. So awesome indeed. Now, season two, Raising Dion. I have already spoken with Gavin Munn, who is apparently his role changes just a little bit in this season, where he's not such of a bad guy. The audience is not going to hate him so much this time.
Mm-hmm.
That little dude is a worker bee, because not only is he on Raising Dion, he's also on The Righteous Gemstones, and he is juggling both of those masterful monster hits at the same time. So hats off to that little man.
Awesome. Yeah, he's amazing.
So Sammy, who plays Esperanza, which is Josiah's best friend on the show and in real life, it turns out.
Yeah.
Josiah, Sammy, Gavin, Carol, and now you. And guess what?
What?
All four of those other people said you were the worst person to work with on the set because you were so mean spirited and you never knew your... No, wait. They said you were the bee's knees.
Aw.
Carol said you're like one of the most professional people she's ever worked with.
Oh.
You know where you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to say, and you have ideas and all that good stuff. She said as far as she knows, you've never given anybody any lip about something you needed to do on any set.
Oh, that's so nice.
Which super confused me because, like I said, I heard you were a terrible person. I even baited all the kids. I was like, so tell me about Jason. Was he really nice or is he just pretending? And they were like, he is the coolest. He like plays catch with us. Like when the camera's not rolling or we're waiting for a shot to turn around, he plays catch with us. He plays tag. He acts all like a monster and chases us and stuff. So all of the kids said that you are the most fun person to have on the set because you act like a little kid with them. And I think that's really cool. Without saying it in those exact words, they said that you get down on their level and play like a kid.
Oh, that's awesome. Well, I do. I remember there was this time in the first season where Josiah and I had a big scene at this pizza parlor. It's one of our first big scenes together. We had already shot some of it. We had a little bit of a break, so we went outside. And for some reason, we got into like a big fireball fight. He was throwing fireballs at me and I was trying to run away and getting hit, and he was fine because he's a kid and that's what kids do. By the end of it, they were like, all right, well, we're ready. And I walked back in and everyone was like, did you jump in a pool? what happened? I was profusely sweating. My hair was completely soaked. My face was wet. My clothes were all soaked. It was so embarrassing. I just had totally forgot about that. I was having so much fun that I forgot that I'm an adult man in shape to a degree, but not enough for, you know, nonstop 20-minute fireball fights, not breaking a sweat. I don't have that kind of stamina within me. So they had to take my shirt off, and there was like three or four hair dryers going on my clothes, my hair, my face. I was very embarrassed that I had created that much extra work for everybody, and that there was a delay because I had been playing so much that we had to dry all my sweat off. So I've been better about that. I pick my moments where I can run around and play like a like an idiot.
I love that story. That is so fun. I love that you forgot that you were an adult male who was at work.
Yeah, exactly. I was just really into that fireball fight.
I love it. The kids, they're all super dope and a lot of fun. And I can't imagine how much fun it is to be on the set with those kids. And then you, who forgets you're an adult male. And, you know, just getting to play in the sandbox of all that creativity. And I mean, it's comic books with superheroes and all that that is the show. This has to be one, and you can say no and I'll cut it out, but this has to be one of your most fun projects to work on, right? How much fun you have on the set at work?
Oh my gosh, yeah, it's so much fun. Everybody that I work with is so sweet and so great. Alicia is such a wonderful lead. You know, she's working all the time, somehow getting it all done, but has such a lovely sort of calming, just sort of in charge energy, and it's just like, she's just the best. I couldn't imagine working with a better lead of a show. She's awesome, and she just knocks it out of the park all the time. So it's a great group of people to work with, and the writing is fun. And then the other side of it that's super fun is just the superhero element. Even though I'm more of a villain, I still get some pretty cool powers, and I still get to, you know, do fun things like that and be in a superhero comic book type world where there are superpowers. And, you know, it's just so much fun growing up and loving that stuff. One of the big thrills is, you know, doing a scene where I'm, even if I'm not directly involved, but I'm supposed to be seeing something magical or powerful or some power in use, and I know they're gonna CGI all of it in later, or they actually do blow something up or whatever it is. Those are the days where I'm just like, this is the coolest ever. Stunts and fights and superpowers, and it's just like, I definitely go back to little 8, 9, 10-year-old me watching Superman or Batman or any of those things.
Sure, the Bionic Man, I'm with you.
Exactly.
Has there ever been a time, and it'd be really cool if it was, but I doubt it, has there ever been a time where you thought it was going to be a CGI effect, and then all of a sudden it was a practical effect, and it like startled you?
I mean, there have definitely been times.
You know, like you're throwing a fireball at a car and you're expecting it to blow up in CGI, but it blows up in real life and scares the pants off of you?
Well, I've never been caught that unaware, because any good stunt team or explosion team will tell you there's always a million, like, here we go, everybody. Is everybody ready? Is everybody far away? Especially Jennifer Badger, who's the head stunt person for Raising Dion. And also I worked with her on Kevin Probably Saves the World. She's just the best. And her team is so great and so professional. But she would never let it happen where we didn't know an explosion was coming. There have been times where I have been startled just because it's very loud. It's almost, in some ways, the anticipation can get you too, because you're like, okay, here it comes, any second. And then it happens and it's loud sometimes. So that I've been startled by, but I've never not known it was coming. They're too professional for that.
You just described every paddling I got when I was in school.
There you go. Exactly.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors. Let's get back into it.
all of the kids are super remarkable to speak with and to interview. And, you know, of course, I thank them and their parents for allowing me the time to do that. But I've got to say, that young man, Josiah Young,
mm-hmm.
he is incredible.
Oh, yeah.
He is one of the most remarkable people I've talked to of any age.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you haven't heard it yet, but during the interview, I had to pause two or three times and be like, are you sure that's the right age? Because you're talking to me like a, you know, like a 19 or 20 year old or even more. I mean, I've had, you know, 30 and 40 year olds who were less with it and less prepared knew less about their craft than he does. So I was completely and utterly impressed by all of the kids, but that little man, holy moly.
He's so cool. And
so respectful.
Yeah, and he's more into it. He was super into it last year, and then it's just like, I think even more so this year. I think it sort of dropped in for him that he's Dion. He's, you know, he gets to be this incredible character, this superhero. I mean, how many kids in single digits get to do that? So yeah, he's just amazing. I love him so much. We had so much fun during the first season. I saw him a little bit less this season, but when we did get to see each other, it was really cool.
All three of those kids are going to go on to be in the business if they want to be, for as long as they want to be. They are so talented and, like I said, just so knowledgeable about what they're supposed to do, and they're taking it all in stride. Gavin was talking about, you know, some of the times that he's had to film, and I think it was on Raising Dion, where it was like raining and 30 degrees outside and everybody was freezing their butts off, and he's just like, well, I mean, this is what I got to do, so I'll get warm later. Like, it's just like water off a duck's back to these kids. They're just like, hey, it is what it is. I said I would do it, so I'm going to do it.
Oh, yeah. Also, the three of them will get together and like make these promos for Raising Dion. They're just like, you know, they're not being commissioned by Netflix. They just love the show. They're passionate about the show. And they're like, let's all get together and we'll film this sketch. And I just love them so much. And the fact that they all take the initiative to do that, you know, it's not just like, hey, it's us, watch Raising Dion. They'll do like a whole thing where they're calling each other and, you know, they're filming it and sending it to each other's parents and they're editing it. And it's just so cool to watch them all do this. I certainly wasn't that motivated when I was their age.
You're not even that motivated to get a haircut and look
That's
at these
true.
Kids.
That
They're
is true.
Being all creative and making things. And yeah, apparently they all get on the phone and just talk to each other all the time.
Yeah.
Like you did when you were in high school with a girl. They all get on the phone and talk together like all the time, once or twice a week, they were saying.
That's so cool. Yeah, it's a genuine friendship, which is awesome. You know, it doesn't always work out that way. But yeah, they've taken it beyond the stage. And I think you can really see that this season with the three of them. They're like a unit.
Energy never dies. It just takes a different form.
Something weird's going on.
I'm going to do everything I can to protect him.
He's strong. He's stronger than he was.
Our army is growing.
Run! Run!
Not going to let you hurt my friends.
Well, the first season, you could definitely see it with Sammy and Jasai, but I can't wait to see how that has grown and then also come to include Gavin. So
yeah.
I'm super excited about this second season. It's going to be so dope.
Yeah, I think you're going to like it.
Now, this is a crazy question for me to ask you. Hey, man, is there going to be a third season?
I hope so. I think, like always, it depends on how many people watch it, how many people engage with it, talk about it, and algorithms and all sorts of things that I don't fully understand. But yeah, and then it'll be up to the powers that be at Netflix to make a decision. But I know we're all gunning for it and excited about it. And, you know, I think season three could be really great. I was excited by the arc of this whole season. Season two, you know, and it feels in line with the themes of the show and the genre of the show that, you know, it seems like it needs to at least be a trilogy, have a little bit of a 1-2-3 punch. It's, yeah, at the very least, it feels like it would sort of complete it. I mean, I would do 9 seasons. Let's go full Star Wars prequels, sequels, let's do it all. But for now, a 3rd season would be awesome.
Well, I think that would be fantastic. And out of purely selfish reasons, that's why I decided to do this landmark podcasting event. Because not only do I want season 2, I want season 3 and beyond. I think that it's awesome that these kids are so young and you're so young. This could go on for a long time. There was a show a long time ago when you and I were kids that was called The Greatest American Hero.
Oh, yeah.
That's the show that most closely reminds me of Raising Dion, because the premise of that show was that this grown man, I believe he was a high school teacher, he stumbles upon this suit, I guess, that was left by aliens, and got all these superpowers. And so the entire show is him learning how to use these superpowers because they didn't come with an instruction book.
That's right.
And so he's trying to fight crime and solve things, but at the same time, he's clumsily learning how to use his powers. And so Raising Dion season 1 reminded me of that only because he was surprised at trying to learn how to use his powers. You know, first he was surprised that he even had powers, and then him and his mom are trying to figure out how to use these powers without getting anybody hurt, namely them.
Yeah.
And then just like The Greatest American Hero, there's some people who find out that they have powers, and it might not be a good thing for everybody to know that these powers are out there. So
exactly.
That's what it reminds me of, except that the writing is better, and so is the acting, and obviously the special effects. But,
yeah,
you know, just sort of the essence of it, of stumbling upon this thing and trying to figure it out while trying to still be a regular person, and, you know, that kind of whole thing is what it reminds me of.
Oh, yeah. That's the exciting thing about the show. I think that's a perfect example to bring up, because I think there are powers that Dion still hasn't discovered within him yet. I think that's one of the things, is it sort of seems to be endless, whereas other people in the world of the show seem to have very sort of specific powers, you know, can grow plants or can disappear or sort of one thing. Dion seems to be able to do a number of them, which is exciting. And yeah, and it leads that element of discovery that's really fun, where we as an audience are figuring it out with him.
Absolutely. We get to go along for the ride, so to speak.
Exactly.
Are you going to go to nerd cons and things like that? Because, you know, it is based on a comic book, and nerds are comic books, and comic books are nerds, and they go to conventions and wait in line for hours to get somebody to sign their nerd comic book. Are you going to nerd, or no? You're all, I'm too busy to go nerding.
Oh, no, I'm never too busy. I love conventions. I mean, I think the first one I went to was one in San Diego.
Oh, yeah, there's one in San Diego? What do they call that one?
Surprisingly, I love all things con. I mean, to me, it feels like a world without bullies or something like that. Like, it's just unbridled joy for stories and characters and costumes and stuff, and no one being like, hey, you think you can pull that off? It's just like all people who love things and are not afraid to show their love for them. And I just, like, the first time I went, I really felt like I'm home. These are my people. This is my planet. So yeah, I would love to do that. I mean, I've been lucky enough, a couple of the projects that I've worked on over the years have fit right in at the con. So I love going with a project, but I also just, you know, if I'm in town and there's one happening, I will buy a pass and just go walk around, and it's just awesome. It's so great. I love it. So yes, if Raising Dion brings us to any of those, I will be there.
So you've been to cons as talent and as a spectator?
Yeah, both. Yeah. And even if I'm there with a project, if I have free time, I'll go walk around and see what I can see and get a couple little toys or whatever's around, figurines, t-shirts, whatever I can. It's just so fun, and they're just so huge, and it's just exciting to have a huge event that has all sorts of people who, there's lots of crossover with whatever you are into. It's just great. And it's also wonderful to see a costume of a character that maybe you think is obscure, and maybe they do too, and you're like, hey, I know who you are, I know what show you're you're from. Just, it's awesome.
Is there a figurine of you somewhere? Is that a thing that exists?
I wouldn't say they're of me, but there are some figurines of some characters that I've played. Like if I've done a voice for an animated thing, you know, there are Gravity Falls figurines, there are Skylanders figurines, Frozen 2 figurines. So there are none that look like me, but if they could talk, they'd hear my voice.
Oh, fantastic. You're not going to get your brother to do it like Tom Hanks did?
Well, no. Is that true? What happened? I don't know that story.
Supposedly, like all the Toy Story stuff that talks, you know, like the little Woody where you pull the string and there's a snake in my boot. Supposedly, Tom got his brother to do all those voiceovers for the toy line. Yeah, supposedly. I mean, I didn't ask Tom, but...
I have heard of that before. I've heard that some people do that. I mean, with your brother, that's amazing. But I know that there are some people who... if they meet or they see on YouTube or whatever, an impressionist that's convincing enough and funny enough that they'll hire them to do all of the toys or commercials or things that they don't want to do.
I mean, at a certain point, especially let's just, you know, go back to the Woody from Toy Story example. At some point, that's got to be a huge job. I mean, yeah, I'm sure that Tom is happy that that was a great success, but he's still trying to make other things. And if for a while there, I'm sure he was just inundated with projects and toys and cartoons and all that stuff. And he had to just be like, oh, man.
Oh, yeah. Games and...
I don't have time for all this.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so that's super cool. I'm sure there's even probably like baby crib mobiles that have his voice and things.
Oh, I bet. I mean, of course, there's got to be.
There better be, right? What did you go to your first con as a talent? What did you go for, if you can remember? And were you in a wheelchair?
I was not. I don't think we went to one for Joan of Arcadia. Or did we? I don't think we did. I think the first time I went to a Comic-Con with something was the event. I think that might have been it.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking you. What event? I'm just kidding.
I keep on forgetting. It's hard to differentiate. I'm here for the event. Yes. Which one? Yeah, but I think that was it. I think we went and we showed the pilot, and it was really exciting. And then I've been there with Gravity Falls a couple of times, too.
I bet. What is Jason Ritter nerdy about?
Oh, boy.
Let's just say you're walking the floor of San Diego Comic-Con. Let your mind run wild. Whatever booth you want to be there is there. What's the nerdiest booth? Like, what are you the nerdiest about that you're going to seek out at San Diego Comic-Con and either get somebody's autograph or meet somebody or buy a figurine or whatever nerd thing it is? What's the thing that you're the most nerdy about?
Oh, boy. That's a good question. I mean, for the most part, I'm just sort of wandering around wide-eyed and just looking at anything. And, you know, there are the shows or the movies that I gravitate towards. Attack on Titan is one thing that, you know, will pique my interest. It's an anime based on a manga series. It's awesome. And there's just quite a lot of Attack on Titan cool stuff. And I mean, to be honest, I don't know if this is embarrassing to say, but it's true. Gravity Falls stuff, even though I'm involved, if I see something that I don't have, I just get it. I'm just a weird collector like that. And I love that show so much, and I'm so proud of it. I don't have like a million hats or anything like that. But if I see some cool thing, especially if it's like an artist made it and it's unique, that definitely always catches my eye.
I love it. I kind of had a feeling you were going to go with the Gravity Falls. Well done.
Yeah, thank you. It's true. I can't ignore it. I can't pretend I'm someone who I'm not.
Even though that is, by definition, your job.
That's true. That is true.
Do you have a copy of the Raising Dion comic book?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I even have it signed by Dennis Liu, who created it.
Whoa.
Yeah.
How cool is that?
It's very cool. He's very involved in the show as well. He directed one episode last season, two episodes this season. He wrote and directed the short film that he based on the comic books that helped get the show made. He's been doing this and cranking it out, and it's awesome. You know, a lot of people, you know, they'll hear that a show wants their property or something and they'll just sell it and move on. And I just feel so grateful that he's been involved the whole time and making sure that his vision stays intact. And he's just such a nice guy on top of it all. He's really great. And I love that he put this story out there in the world.
Well, I think that is awesome. And that's just one more thing that you and your dad have in common. There's not a whole lot of times that a short film is made to help get a feature film made, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
That was the story with Billy Bob Thornton and Sling Blade, which your dad was in, and then also, you know, Raising Dion. They made the short film so that they could get the actual full-length feature made. I think that's super dope.
That's true. I never put that together.
Well, I'm here for you, buddy.
I appreciate that. Yeah, I remember seeing the short of Sling Blade. They basically reshot it for the movie because it's sort of that first sequence where he has the monologue. It's like, I think it ends with him being released. And then the feature is obviously that whole first part in the hospital and then what happens after he's released and stuff. Right. But I'm still bowled over by that movie and all the performances in that movie. I just think are so beautiful and it's amazing. Yeah, the short film is as intense as any of it.
And so is the short film of Raising Dion. I watched it online.
Oh, yeah. It's great. It's awesome. It really, like, special effects, especially for a short film. It's like, how did you get this done? It's hard to raise money for a short film because a lot of short films are used as calling cards and look what I can do. And, you know, but they're not money making. So you basically need people, your friends or your family to believe in you enough to sort of donate some or put it up yourself, which I don't know what's the case in Dennis's case. But yeah, I mean, a lot of short filmmakers just sort of scrape it together themselves. It's a pretty beautiful and worthwhile endeavor, especially when something cool and fun comes from it.
Absolutely. Full-length features, there's no guarantee you're going to get your money back. But on short films, there is a guarantee that you won't. So,
yeah, almost guaranteed. Unless it gets to the Oscars or something.
Even then, it's barely makes the money back sometimes. Unless it gets turned into something or, like you said, used as a calling card. So, Jason, Mr. Ritter, I cannot believe that I got to talk to you again.
Oh, thanks.
You literally are top five nicest people in Hollywood, at least the ones that I have spoken with and gotten to meet. You're impressive in that regard because it seems like you're truly grateful for not just the things you have in your life, but the people and the experiences and the opportunities that you have in your life. And that's a rare breed in any industry, but maybe especially in yourn.
Thank you. I appreciate that. That for sure rings true to me. I mean, I think sometimes loss can sort of make you take stock of the things that are really important and the things that are replaceable and the things that aren't replaceable. And also when, you know, my dad was alive, he put a lot more stock into the important things. You know, he would always kind of talk to us about what was important, what was not, what was impressive, what was not, you know, and a lot of the extra things that can sometimes come along with a life of someone who's chose to be an actor. If they get successful, a lot of people can get successful there, but in the very narrow definition of success that's usually applied to actors in Hollywood, certain things like fame and things like that can come along that don't really have much value in and of themselves. You know, we can be famous and a terrible person. I think he always was sort of much more interested in how we all treat other people and big on the old golden rule. So I think once that's drilled into somebody, it's kind of hard to forget. You sort of go, oh, right. So would I like to be talked to like this? No. So why do I think it's okay to talk to this person like this?
I love it.
Yeah. So that's all. But I really appreciate that. That's very nice of you.
I mean, I guess it was nice, but I don't really think it was nice because, hey, man, I'm just stating the facts, bro. You can see it on screen and you can see it more when you're doing a thing that you're not doing, like, that's not scripted. You know, like when you're talking about your dad or when you're doing an interview or whatever, it really comes through how much you appreciate your life and life in general. Jason Ritter, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day and your hectic schedule to hang out and let us get to know even more about you on Fascination Street. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Let's do it again.
Oh, you should not have said that. Ooh. All right, everybody. Season 2 of Raising Dion is out right now. It's on Netflix. This has been the end of a wonderfully fantastic week. This is a podcasting event, the likes of which I've never done before in my approaching 300 episodes.
Whoa.
So earlier this week, we had Sammy Haney. Earlier this week, we had Gavin Munn. Earlier this week, we had Josiah Young. Earlier this week, we had Carol Barbie. And now today, we're wrapping this up with Jason Ritter. Go check out the show. Season 2 is available right now on Netflix. If you don't have Netflix, what are you, an alien from space and things? Go watch Season 2. It's out right now. Jason Ritter, tell everybody where they can find you.
You can find me at the grocery store.
Ralph's?
Yeah, Ralph's. I'll be at Ralph's. Okay. You can find me on Twitter. I'm at Jason Ritter. On Instagram, I'm at Jason_Ritter. I wish they were all the same thing, but I don't know how people get that. You just the luck of the draw. TikTok, I'm Jason Ritter 1980 because, you know, everything is always taken. I'm the last to join and I pay the consequences. But yeah, those are my three main things.
Other than Raising Dion, is there anything that you want to promote as we're heading out?
Yeah, there's a also on Netflix a cartoon called Captain Fall that is either out or not out. I don't have a date for that as well, but it's coming or it's already here. And then there's another show called Cuddle that's based on the Slumberkins books, a kids show that I'm really proud to be a part of. That should be around soon or now as well.
You should do some adult shows. And I don't mean that in the dirty way. I just mean you're doing a bunch of kid stuff. What's going on, bro?
Well, Captain Fall is not for the kiddos, I would say. It is animated, but not for the Cuddle or Raising Dion fans, I would say. I think, make sure your mom and dad know you want to watch it before. Maybe you have them watch a couple of episodes before they let you watch.
Oh, nice. Sort of like Bill Burr's F is for Family.
Yeah, it's pretty intense.
Fantastic. Well, like I said earlier, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy day. You go tell Melanie and that I said hello.
I will tell Melanie, and I'm sure you mean my daughter somehow, but I will tell them that you said hello.
Yes, your daughter, whose name is not known.
Yes.
She's ethereal.
Not even to us.
Yeah, not even to you. I think it's super cool that y'all aren't. I couldn't even find it anywhere online. So that is awesome. So make sure you tell Melanie I said hi. That way you can laugh when she looks at you all weird and says, who? With her lovely accent.
I will do that.
You have a great, great week. And thank you so much.
Thank you so much. You too.
Have a great day, Jason.
You too. Talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
Opening music is the song FSP Theme, written, performed, and provided by Ambush Ven.
Closing music is from the song Say My Name off the 2021 album Underdog Anthems, used with permission from Jax Hollow. If you like the show, tell a friend, subscribe, and rate and review the show on iTunes and wherever else you download podcasts. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. All the episodes are available there as well. Check me out on Vero at Fascination Street Pod and TikTok at Fascination Street Pod. And again, thanks for listening.